Whenever my students get to know that my mother and father died together in a horrible car accident a few short weeks before I started my university education, their questions are often many. Professor, how did you cope? Professor, how were you able to continue your education to the point where you are now a professor? How come you always come to class so happy and cheerful? My answer is often the same. Enthusiasm. Enthusiasm for life, enthusiasm for learning. The word enthusiasm evolved from the Greek word enthous. En meaning within, theos meaning God. Enthusiasm is the God within. To have enthusiasm is to be divinely inspired. How apt. Before my parents died, they had given my siblings and me enthusiasm for learning. They did this directly by promoting formal learning, but their indirect methods also left a lasting impact. I can still remember as a child watching my father go to the bookcase in our living room. Papa would open the bookcase, take out a book, beat up the dust from the cover, read aloud the title and author, shake his head, open the book, flip some pages, smile to himself, close the book, and put it back in the bookcase. As soon as he would leave, I would rush to the bookcase. I would try to identify the book. I would take it, open the pages, trying to discover for myself what had elicited such a dramatic reaction from him. It is from experiences like this that I also developed enthusiasm for learning. It is that enthusiasm that has seen me traverse 3 continents, Africa, Europe, and North America, in search of advanced university degrees, which have now propelled me in front of a university classroom in the United States of America. However, in spite of my own enthusiasm, I did not start my tenure at the University of Hartford teaching enthusiasm. I taught the courses I was hired to teach, which include Introduction to Literature, African-American Literature, Literature Across Non-Western Cultures, and English Composition. In addition, I made sure I paid close attention to students' evaluations at the end of each semester. These evaluations came with a lot of recommendations. I made sure I objectively included these recommendations as I prepared my lessons and reviewed my teaching strategies each semester. Then I started noticing another kind of feedback. It was passionate, enthusiastic, and above all, it was unsolicited. For example, several weeks after Lee Daniels, the butler, came out, I received an email from one of my students who had taken my African-American literature course. And this is what she wrote. Good afternoon, Professor Ashuntantang. I kept telling myself to email you about the film The Butler for weeks now. I am emailing you to see if you were able to watch it. And I also wanted to tell you that it tied in with your class. If you haven't seen it yet, I advise you to do so. You will love it. I was inspired to read this. When I wrote back to the student telling her how elated I was that she had found connections between what we discussed in class and the movie, she wrote back, "Yes, I loved your class, and it is so fascinating how much it has become a part of my life. Many things jump out at me, and I sit there, and I'm like, man, if only Professor Ash saw this." This was uplifting to read. It was clear that I had given this student fresh eyes to see the world. This gave me the kind of satisfaction that I had 2 semesters before when another student took me by surprise. She came in to hand in her final exam paper, and then she told me, "Professor, I have something to show you." Then she revealed a tattoo on her body. The tattoo read, "Adumarandan." Adumarandan is a Yoruba word which means one whose blackness is the beauty of her skin. In my course, Literature Across Non-Western Cultures, we had not only studied a poem with that title by Niyu Shundare from his collection, Tender Moments, I had organized a Skype session with a prolific poet where he read the poem in English and in Yoruba. Later, the student sent me this email. When I was growing up, being a darker complexion was something I didn't like. And in today's society, it is shown that beautiful black women have a lighter complexion. So I struggled with being comfortable in my skin. My tattoo, Adumarandan, will be my way of showing the world that the blackness of my skin is beautiful and I love it. I plan on taking this book of poetry with me many years from now. This class was a blessing. This was so satisfying. It was evident that the poem Adumarandan and others in the collection had validated this student's sense of being and enhanced her self-confidence. This book of poetry had become much more than a college textbook. It was the kind of feedback that resonated with something palpable inside me. I was moved. Then there was the freshman who sent me this email. Professor Ash, I'm writing a final paper for US history, and the topic is, how did US become so dominant by 1950? And the answer is, all the events that led up to 1950, progressive era, World War I, booming 20s, depression, and World War II. Do you think I could write a process analysis essay? Wondering if that would be a good idea. I still remember my reaction. I exclaimed in front of my laptop, of course, as if he could see me. Process analysis essays are directions explaining how something is done, how something works, and how something happens. We had studied process analysis as a rhetorical mode in my English composition class. Here was a student who was critically analyzing new ideas in his history class and connecting them with ideas in my English composition class. Educators will identify this as evidence of deeper learning. Again, it was the kind of feedback that tugged something inside me. Here, these students were not just enthusiastic about new ideas that they were gaining, they were enthusiastic about sharing their new ways of seeing. I started craving this kind of feedback. I started working harder to replicate this unsolicited feedback. Then I remembered a quote I had read somewhere. What makes your heart sing? If you don't take the time to think about the answer, really think about it, you may never know the joy and success that you are truly capable of achieving. I realized I love to teach and to facilitate learning. But what makes my heart sing is when there is concrete evidence that I got students excited, enthusiastic about learning beyond my classroom. As a result, I started working even harder to use innovative teaching strategies that would facilitate learning, that would promote long-term enthusiasm. In one class, we created Twitter and Facebook pages on key characters in Chinua Achebe's Things Fall Apart. As students posted status updates, they were able to explore plot and characterization. In another class, I experimented with flipping the classroom, which enabled me to assess students' preparedness before class so as to maximize class time. In another, I continued organizing Words Like Trees, a college-wide Black History Month event where students in my African American literature course gave voice to inspirational words by African American writers and leaders. As the students practiced, the students gained confidence in their own words, and some of them wrote memorable pieces which they performed enthusiastically. Recently, I received one of the awards for innovations in teaching and learning at the University of Hartford. It was a welcome validation for all my efforts. I am energized by this award to do even more, but my end goal remains the same, that which makes my heart sing. I want to make a positive impact on my students that would continue to energize them long after they leave my classroom. After the sudden, painful, tragic deaths of my parents, enthusiasm has been my key to the world. I want to give my students the best of me. I want to give them that key. This is why I teach enthusiasm.